we're going to talk about the Gilgamesh. Gilgamesh is the great epic poem of Mesopotamia. Mesopotamia, the Greek name for the Tigris and Euphrates rivers. The earliest, there are many versions, many traces of this poem remaining. The earliest ones from about 2000 BC. They are in Sumerian. And basically the myth is Sumerian. The Sumerians were the first civilized people, maybe in the world. They usually share that distinction with the inhabitants of the Nile and with the Indus Valley in India, Pakistan, along there. But the Sumerians were early, maybe certainly greater, the greatest of the three. Anyway, Gilgamesh appears to be to have actually lived, or at least there was the fifth king of Uruk, one of the cities. The Sumerian civilization was especially a city-state, like the Greek. They combined sometimes, but often they kept their rivalries, fought all the time, it's true, but achieved great things. Other versions, much more complete, are in Hittite and Hurrian. The students of the Bible know about these people. Their languages are Semitic, like Hebrew. But the most complete version was found in the ruins of the great library of Ashurbanipal of Nineveh, the capital of the Assyrian Empire. And this library was destroyed by the Persians in 612 BCE. It was an amazing library, and the most complete version of the poem was found in those ruins. That version dates from about 700 BC, but is based on much earlier things. So you who are interested in history at all can think of Homer. Homer having lived around 750 BC. But this poem had been, the Gilgamesh was preserved and transmitted, written in cuneiform. All those languages were written in wedge-like figures, cuneiform, on clay, which lasts much longer than paper or papyrus or anything like that, for more than 1,000 years at least. So the poem was preserved well. It was added to over the centuries, but a very conservative mentality kept it, and it's kept close to its original traditions. Of course, it's a mixture of kind of popular myth and sophisticated courtly intellect. But high and low could appreciate it, well-educated and not, and here we go. It's difficult. The version that exists most completely exists on 12 tablets. It's really only the first 11 that are relevant. The only complete or almost complete tablet is number 11. That's the most famous, for good and bad reasons, because that's the tablet that tells about the flood. And their students of Genesis were horrified to discover that the authors of Genesis borrowed a lot from Gilgamesh. But everyone should realize that the Hebrew Bible is heavily influenced by the Fertile Crescent, as it's called, that area of the ancient world covering Mesopotamia and arcing down to Egypt. The cultures there were international and heavily influenced each other. More of that later. Okay, who was Gilgamesh then? Gilgamesh was a king a great king, the most powerful of all mortals. He was the king of Uruk, and in this story he's a young man. He's two-thirds divine, one-third mortal. But as he gradually learns, his mortality is fatal, that is, he will die. The most important theme, probably, of the poem is his discovery of his mortality and his struggle to elude, avoid his mortality, find immortality somehow, and so forth. The parallel here between Gilgamesh and Achilles in the Iliad is very powerful, because really, ultimately, the Iliad is about Achilles' struggle with his own mortality and his violent attempts to stop thinking about it, much more psychological, really, and in the end, his grudging acceptance of his mortality. Pretty much in very general terms, the same thing happens to Gilgamesh in a very different way, but there are powerful similarities, not only superficially, but on a profound level. Okay, the 12 tablets then. I first read this book, and this has become kind of a famous, even standard text, a translation, but translation and adaptation by a man named Herbert Mason. Great cover. Look, it's a very thin book, and the pages, not many words on the pages either. This is a very personal book, though, by Herbert Mason, and it doesn't pretend to be entirely a translation. He refashions the material in some ways to express what for him was personal grief at the loss of a good friend. Now, Gilgamesh, in the poem, loses his great friend Enkidu. Achilles, in the Iliad, loses his great friend Patroclus. Herbert Mason adapts this material to express his own grief, but really it's not safe to say that this is a translation. It's a personal adaptation. What does he say? A verse narrative? No. But it's a retelling, you might say. Okay, but that's okay. It's very useful and moving what he does. Okay, in the first tablet, we learn that Gilgamesh was a great and powerful king who built the city, especially the walls and the gates of Uruk, which was a magnificent city. He had all knowledge. He was not only a god in his strength, his superhuman strength, but also he had great knowledge too, as the opening lines tell. But he was not a very good king. If we look into this a little bit, I haven't speculated about this, but here's what he does. He is kind of cruel to his people. And sexually, he enforces a law which had existed before, that he, as the king, had the right to sleep with the brides of men who got married on the first night, before the husband got to sleep with the bride. The king slept with these brides. And he had many other women and girls, so sexually he was voracious, predacious, a predator. Now, maybe we should examine this a little bit, because such appetency, such excessive lust, is of course not really lust. This is not the need of the body to satisfy itself. This is the need, a kind of twisted pathological need of the spirit to find rest, satisfaction, pleasure, capital P. It's a delusion. Like all of the seven deadly sins are, After all, lust is one of the seven deadly sins, and it would seem that Gilgamesh is guilty of this at this point, because it's pathological. It's not natural. And so, I haven't read anything about this, and I don't remember my hero Kirk, G.S. Kirk, great Greek scholar, professor at Cambridge, whom I met a couple of times and talked with a couple of times when I was in Cambridge. He was kind to me, though our association was very brief. I don't remember what he says, but anything he says on anything is enlightening. But that pathological aspect of Gilgamesh's voracious, deserves some close attention. Similar to Achilles' anger at Agamemnon at the beginning of the Iliad. His anger at Agamemnon is not anger at Agamemnon, and we need only look a little closely to see this. It's anger at a bunch of other things, foremost among which his own mortality. Gilgamesh's sexual voracity at the beginning is something similar. Something similar is going on, and I think in the end, probably, it's the rumblings in him of a sense of his own mortality, because that's what will happen in the book. So the people of Uruk beg the gods for some help, and Anu, the sky god, then makes Enkidu, E-N-K-I-D-U-U. Enkidu was kind of a natural man, a wild, primitive man of the wilderness and the uncivilized areas around Uruk. He runs with the animals. He's a hairy, powerful animal, much more powerful than any animal. But he also releases animals from the traps that the trappers out there try to catch animals in. So a trapper's son, the first significant character of the story, in a sense, of the action, trapper's son sees Enkidu running with the animals. He goes to his own father, and his own father says, "Go to Uruk, tell King Gilgamesh about this man, and go to the temple prostitutes. Go find a temple prostitute. What was her name? Shamhat. I'd like to find her name, just a second. Shamhat. Take Shamhat out there to a watering hole where the animals can water. She will seduce Enkidu, and this will be the beginning of civilizing Enkidu." This is exactly what happens. And Enkidu loses a lot of his physical strength, it seems, as a result of this seduction. But he starts to gain civilized values. He then lives with the shepherds for a while, and he learns to speak, he learns to eat properly, he learns to wear clothes, shave, things like that. He's becoming civilized. Then he decides to go to Uruk to meet Gilgamesh. Okay, he arrives at Uruk on the day when Gilgamesh was going to sleep with a bride or several brides, I don't know, that night to enjoy his power. Let's get beyond sexuality here. Sexuality like this is an enjoyment of power, and it has almost nothing to do with a sex drive. It seems obvious to me. It's about power. It's about enjoying power over others. And I suspect that the enjoyment here is not enjoyment of power over women and the submission of women. It's enjoyment of power over the men whom he thus humiliates or hurts. That's what that power is. In 1984, O'Brien says, "What do men want most of all? Power. But the only way that they know that they have power is by inflicting suffering on others." That's exactly what Gilgamesh is doing, right there. So, Enkidu is outraged by Gilgamesh's behavior, and he blocks the door to the mayor's chamber. They fight. They have a terrible fight. These are the two most powerful of all humans. Gilgamesh wins. But Gilgamesh then embraces Enkidu as his great friend, and the friendship is sealed. By the way, before Enkidu came, Gilgamesh had two dreams, and the dreams are very interesting. One dream is that a meteorite would come down from the sky on Earth. He, Gilgamesh, would examine it and then embrace it as a wife. Sexual, it seems. The second dream is that an axe head, A-X-E, would come down. Same thing. He, Gilgamesh, would examine it and then embrace it as a wife. He asks his mother, Rimat Ninsun, R-I-M-A-T, hyphen, N-I-N-S-U-N, which is written Ramat Ninsun a couple of places. I don't know which is correct. That's ridiculous. And by the way, some of my information I got from the internet. And isn't it typical? Every time I have gone to the internet for scholarship or information, I almost always find it flawed. So these are secondary, I mean, these are not important scholars who put their stuff on internet, as everybody knows. And one has to watch this information with some caution. I mean, I who know nothing or little about internet know this, and I guess everybody else knows this too. Okay. Okay, so when they embrace, one internet source makes this clearly a homosexual relationship, and I guess it is. I guess it is. It's not explicit, but it is implicit. As such, that's interesting too. Does that mean an endorsement of homosexuality? Well, let's talk about this for a second. The more a culture suppresses and demeans women, the less men will respect women in that culture. The more likely men are to seek out homosexual relationships, because the men are the only equals intellectually that they'll find. That's an interesting phenomenon, and I suspect it's probably universal. I wonder if it happened in Korea too. I know that, or at least I gather that homosexuality, past or present, is a much taboo, no talk about topic among Koreans. But from what I know about the Joseon dynasty, women were not treated well. Women were chattel. In Joseon anyway, and I assume in earlier dynasties, but I don't know that. And that makes me suspect that men probably sought out intimacy with other men. Check it out. Just a little speculation there. But this kind of thinking certainly applies to the ancient Greeks of 5th century Athenian and Spartans. That is, the women were held down, and not surprisingly, the men sought intimacy with each other. And I'm sure this is the case of Sumeria and some of these other cultures too. Interesting. The point is, the women whom men find in their society, can they respect them as people or not? If they can respect them, then they can have full intimacy with them. If they can't respect them, they won't find that kind of ultimate intimacy that people seek. I think that's what's going on here. Okay, so they become good friends, and Enkidu stays in Uruk with his friend. In a sense, Gilgamesh is the master, he's the king, but Gilgamesh is very devoted to Enkidu as an almost equal. They get soft a little bit, though, in civilization. And Kirk, I now remember, Kirk is very interested in what is a very important aspect of the poem that he points out, and that is that what the author or authors, by the way, there is an author of the Assyrian version, Shin Ekiunini, the oldest known author maybe of any work of literature in the world. We don't know of which or of how much he's the author. I suspect relatively little. But the point that Kirk makes is it's certainly interesting. That is, what the author or authors are doing in many parts of the Gilgamesh is examining nature versus culture. Kirk then examines this concept and applies it to Book 10, Book 9 of the Odyssey, the key story between Odysseus and the Cyclops, Polyphemus, who is a curious mixture of culture and nature. Very interesting, and I think he's right. This is what the author is doing. Not necessarily drawing conclusions either. Juxtaposing, setting side by side. I have a minute because I won't run out of time here. In the Cyclops episode, Book 9 of the Odyssey, we get this curious mixture that the Cyclops represents. Uncivilized, wild, reject agriculture, reject assemblies and laws, live wild and alone. But loving animals, vegetarian most of the time, gentle, affectionate with animals. Well, this is like Enkidu. And so, on the other hand, when Odysseus arrives, becoming cannibalistic, devouring men, he eats six of them, remember? That's what Kirk is talking about in the Gilgamesh too. Okay, so they're getting soft, Gilgamesh and Enkidu, and Gilgamesh decides we need an adventure. We're going to go to the cedar, the forest of cedar. It's got some better name for it. Cedar Forest in Iran, southern Iran, which is guarded as sacred and very beautiful, guarded by Humbaba, who is a fierce giant, far more powerful than any people. Enkidu has seen this in his wanderings with the animals, this guy, and Enkidu says no, Enkidu's afraid. The element of fear of both Enkidu and Gilgamesh in this whole episode, intermittent fear, is really interesting. Now the other becomes afraid, and the other tries to support, even force, the one to be brave, have courage. Very interesting. Okay, so off they go to the forest. Another interesting thing is that Gilgamesh, all along in this episode, prays to Shamash. Shamash is the sun god, and of all the gods, he seems to be the most powerful. Gilgamesh prays to him often, kind of like Odysseus does with Zeus and Athena in his trial with the suitors. Very interesting. Okay, they get there, and he prays once more to Shamash, and Shamash calls out to him, attack now, because Humbaba is wearing only one of his seven coats of armor. With the seven coats of armor, they would never defeat him. But with only one, he is vulnerable. Attack. But Enkidu, terrified, wants to run away. And the two of them start to fight, because Gilgamesh says, no, stay, stay, stay. Humbaba hears the noise and comes out. What's going on here? Then the two of them attack. The great epic battle ensues, and with the help of Shamash, Humbaba is defeated. Then a strange thing. Gilgamesh hesitates to kill Humbaba, but Enkidu says, go ahead, do it, and you will have, before the gods come, and you will have immortal fame. But before Gilgamesh beheads Humbaba, Humbaba puts a curse on Enkidu. May you die first. and you will die before Gilgamesh. Head gone. Well, lots of things are interesting here. For one thing, Humbaba is mortal then. He could die. And it seems that the gods, though immortal in name, there are some strange things going on here that remind me of the Circe incident in Book 10 of the Odyssey, where, with Hermes' help, Odysseus eats the moly, and then he attacks Circe, and Circe is terrified. Well, Circe is immortal. Why should Circe be terrified? What's going on here? Similar things happen here. Okay, so they cut down the cedar forest. They then float down the river Tigris, I think, or Euphrates, to Uruk with some of the cedar forest, because they build the great cedar gate at Uruk out of this forest. And this gate is one of the marvels, one of the glories of Uruk. And I'll return to that at the very end. Okay, now here they are home again. Gilgamesh bathes and cleans himself up and dresses in glorious clothes. And Ishtar, who is apparently Aphrodite, a goddess of sexuality, let's say, tries to seduce him. But Gilgamesh insults her, says, "No, go away. I want nothing to do with you, because every one of the heroes whom you've taken as lovers has ended very badly, and I don't want this to happen to me." But what I think is really happening here is that he's rejecting woman love for the love of Enkidu. Somewhat obvious. Now, Ishtar then goes to her father, Anu, the sky god, and complains, and even says, "If you don't give me the bull of heaven, or send the bull of heaven down to kill, to destroy Uruk, and kill Gilgamesh and Enkidu, I will turn hell loose, the souls of hell loose," and blah 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 blah. I don't remember, but it's a terrible threat. So Anu is forced, sends the bull of heaven down, but then the second great battle of Enkidu and Gilgamesh versus some force takes place, and this time they kill the bull of heaven. So I guess the bull of heaven wasn't immortal either. And then Enkidu does something strange. He takes the thigh of the bull of heaven and threatens Ishtar, says, "We're going to kill you next," and throws that thigh into her face. Wait a minute. Kill Ishtar? Ishtar is immortal. What is this? So there are all kinds of ambiguities here that I wonder what's going on here. In a sense, here's my idea of what's going on here. It just occurs to me now. Men create gods. Men can't stand the gods, for the gods to be totally immortal. Or let's say, can't stand the thought that they are totally immortal. And they find ways to make them mortal. Wow. Is this what Christianity is? That is, we found a way to make God mortal. Make him Jesus Christ, Jesus of Nazareth. And then crucify him, right? But then we reassure ourselves that he is immortal. He sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and so forth. But in my opinion, I would love to explore this idea. We always find ways to make our gods mortal. Backdoor, secretive ways, ways that we don't even fully acknowledge. It seems to me most people's conception of God is so anthropomorphic that that's the way we make our gods, so to speak, mortal. We certainly make them just like us. Are we mortal? Of course we are. Do we find ways to make our gods mortal? Every time. Every time. We're incapable of worshiping a truly immortal God. We're incapable of grasping the concept of immortality anyway, in the first place. were incapable of taking deity seriously anyway. Wow, big idea here. Thanks, Dr. Shin. Okay, so, then Ishtar is angry, the gods are angry, they send a sickness to Enkidu. Enkidu suffers tremendously for 12 days. At first, Enkidu learns that the gods have decided to punish, somebody has to be punished, Gilgamesh or Enkidu, and they decide that it's got to be Enkidu. Enkidu thinks this is not fair, and he curses the harlot, the prostitute who seduced him, curses the trapper and the trapper's son who changed him from being a natural, spontaneous creature in harmony with nature to a civilized man. But then Shamash, the sun god, apparently speaks to Enkidu and says, look, your life is true has been kind of short, but it's been great, and you've known the glories of civilization. You've known Gilgamesh, you've known glory. Be thankful. And Enkidu changes his mind and blesses the prostitute, blesses the trapper and the trapper's son, who brought him out of his animal spontaneous, assuming animals are spontaneous, out of his natural condition into the state of civilization. More Kirk here, and he's certainly right. The authors are juxtaposing and examining the relative virtues or blessings of natural state and civilized culture state. Very interesting. It's in Book 7. Before he dies, Enkidu has a dream. And he dreams of hell, what we would call hell, the afterlife. And it's a very, very dismal thing. Kind of similar to the dismal thing that Homer begins Book 11 with when Odysseus arrives there in the Odyssey. It's a dismal place, and the people there have no minds, no spirits, and flit around like little bats in a cave. But then they drink this stuff, and gradually in Book 11 they don't have to drink this stuff. I would say, maybe, that this is Homer himself backing away from his original conception of Hades Halls as a terrible, dismal place, backing away from that and turning it into something very human and almost enjoyable. I think that's what's happening. That's what happens to the Homeric tradition there anyway. In the end, man is not very capable of looking at very pessimistic or very dismal conclusions about anything. We will always find ways to embellish. We can't look seriously at our mortality, at our human condition, at our vanity and silliness. We can't look at it very long, because we can't look at anything serious very long. That's part of what it means to be a human being. We are so silly, I'm afraid. Our childishness comes out in Gilgamesh too. I've got plenty of time. I'm going to show this. The author, I think, is pretty serious here, more serious than Homer, maybe. Moving on. In Book 7, then Enkidu dies after suffering tremendously for 12 days. Book 8, very short, lost mostly, is about Gilgamesh's grief. And his grief for Enkidu is tremendous. And he apparently builds some monument to Enkidu, but we don't know what it is. But by Book 9, where Gilgamesh is really falling apart, doesn't shave, doesn't bathe, neglects himself, is in just a terrible state, we realize that Gilgamesh is not just grieving over his lost friend or lover or whatever we want to call him, he's grieving over his own mortality. And that's Achilles in Book 16, 17, 18, too. That's Achilles throughout the Iliad, grieving over his own mortality. His way of doing this, Achilles, is to turn it to wrath and anger. And arguably, the main point of the Iliad, as I may not have said before, arguably is I think what Homer is saying is that Achilles uses his anger to cloud his own thinking, to prevent himself from looking clearly at his own mortality. After all, as long as he's angry and lashing out and killing, he can't think, or won't think, about his own mortality. He uses anger to veil, to cloud his own perception of his own mortality. Wow. Now, something kind of similar goes on with Gilgamesh. He decides that he can't live with his own mortality. And that's a, he's in a more advanced stage than Achilles in that sense. He can't live with his own mortality. He must find immortality. And so he learns about Utnapishtim, Utnapishtim. Utnapishtim. Utnapishtim had been a king before the flood. And like Noah, he was spared, he and his wife, and various animals. The gods decided for some reason to destroy everybody. The god Enlil, I don't know who Enlil is, but Enlil is angry at humanity, wants them all wiped out. Just as God in Genesis decides they must all be destroyed. But one righteous man, Noah, one righteous man, Utnapishtim, and his wife. So, but the gods in their secret council had said, we must all promise not to warn people. This is final. But Ea, a god, cheats. And he goes and tells, he doesn't tell Utnapishtim, but he tells the house of Utnapishtim, a little technicality, about the oncoming flood, and tells him, advises him to build a big boat, take his wife and some belongings, gold and silver, and each of the animals two by two, take them on the boat too, the flood will come. The flood comes with terrible fury. Even the gods are afraid. Gods are afraid? You see what I mean. We make our gods human. Why should a god be afraid of anything? But anyway. Terrible thunder. What's the thunder god's name? I don't remember, but it doesn't matter. Anyway. I need to find that. Tells the walls. Adad. Adad is, I guess, the thunder god. And he thunders and it rains for 7 days, seven nights. Terrible. At the end of the flood, we get the sending out of a dove, a sparrow, and a raven. These details are in the Noah account in Genesis, and the parallels are really something. The boat comes to rest on a mountain, just like it does Ararat in Genesis. Forget the name of the mountain, but it doesn't matter. Oh, no, why am I telling the story of the flood? This is the story, getting ahead of myself. Gilgamesh decides to go to find Utnapishtim. Utnapishtim tells him the story of the flood. This is in tablet 11, the most complete of all the tablets. So I'm getting way ahead of myself. But I'll finish the story there. After the flood, Utnapishtim and his wife and the animals leave the boat. Enlil is furious that a mortal has survived. But Ea, who had told the walls to build the boat, pacifies Enlil, and in Enlil blesses Utnapishtim and his wife and makes them immortal and sends them to live at the source of all the rivers far away. And maybe Utnapishtim's name means far away. Kind of like the Isles of the Blessed in Greek myth. Never treated very thoroughly, as far as I know. They're just kind of mysteriously there somewhere, where Menelaus and Helen and some of the other immortal or semi-immortals will live, and their spouses, like Menelaus. What? What? What is this nonsense? Okay. So, now to deal with the journey, Gilgamesh's journey. It's going to be a terrible journey. He journeys... His best quality throughout all this is his persistence. But we recall that his persistence is based on his fear of death, basically. Okay, so he travels and travels. He gets to this mountain, Mount Mashu, I think. And there are two scorpions, and the scorpions warn him, don't try, man is mortal. It's futile to try, but he's going to go on anyway. So then he travels, it seems allegorical, really. He travels for 11 days through darkness. Wow. On the 12th day, he gets some glimmer of light, and he enters a gem garden with gems everywhere, emeralds and rubies and beautiful things. It's a beautiful garden. But by the way, notice, gem garden, nature, culture. Nature, culture. Lots of this. I'm sure Kirk brilliantly gets into this. Then he leaves that and he comes to a tavern on the edge of the river, of the ocean. And this must be kind of like the river ocean in Greek Homeric myth and Hesiodic myth too. There he comes to a tavern? Tavern? And the owner, the runner of the tavern is Siduri, a woman, who is terrified at the sight of Gilgamesh, who must look pretty terrible at this time. But he convinces her that he's the king of Uruk. She should care that he's the king of Uruk? I don't know. But she too tells him, don't try. Man is mortal, irretrievably, irreversibly mortal. Don't try. Okay, but she relents too. The gods in these stories, by the way, just every time, all the way to the end, are constantly relenting. That is, they tell mortals, they tell Gilgamesh this, it's impossible, okay, if you try this, you might succeed. But the gods obviously know that Gilgamesh will not succeed. And so, the author, what's the author doing here? I think the author is showing us that we will always try to circumvent death. We will always try to circumvent death by inventing myths or inventing religions or inventing values that allow us to circumvent death. And yet, in the end, there's always death. And in the end, our circumventions are not fully convincing, not fully acceptable. In the end, these are fabrications that we make to try to veil or help us avoid staring at death and our own mortality. And that's what the author is doing here, because again and again, it's pointless. You cannot avoid it. Okay, try this. Gilgamesh will fail. Oh my God, I'm mortal. The gods changed their mind. Okay, try this. Fail again. Oh my God, I'm mortal. Okay, try this. Fail again. I'm mortal. And the gods will relent every time in these stories. But the author must see this from a bigger perspective, see our inability to accept our own mortality, our inability even to perform successfully the tasks that we have to perform to avoid mortality. But the gods kind of love us because of our, I think we have a kind of childish charm. Through all our brutality, there is a childishness that emerges in us in these myths, and I believe it. I believe it. There's a kind of childish charm about our fear of death, about our childish attempts to circumvent death, about our childish attempts to invent gods. But every time we invent a god, we will reduce that god to something like us. And the gods, whatever they are, must love this about us. It's kind of lovable, kind of like one watches the childishness of children. And the great authors, I think, maybe see this. though even the great authors in the end back away from the big truths. And this includes the philosophers and the religious thinkers too. In the end, they back away. We back away from truth. We can't look at it. We will find ways to embellish it. We will find ways to disguise it. We will find ways that make us seem a little better, a little worthier of immortality, and we will invent silly myths to make it a possibility. Sorry, that's the way it obviously is. Okay, he finds Utnapishtim. Utnapishtim tells him the myth. First of all, no, he comes to the shore, another long journey. First, he's Siduri, back at Siduri, the tavern keeper. She tells him, you must go to find Urshanabi. Urshanabi, S-H-A-N-A-B-I. He's the ferryman for Utnapishtim, and he will guide you across the waters of death. But Gilgamesh approaches Urshanabi with arrogance, and he destroys the stone things that are the only thing that will let Gilgamesh get across the waters of death. So here's man, even given special chances and opportunities through our arrogance and silliness and our humanity, we are incapable of fully embracing, fully even accepting the gifts of the gods that might enable us to be immortal. But all that's silly too, because we are what we are. Oh my God, you've destroyed the stone things, and those are the only things that will let you get across the waters of death and find Utnapishtim. But here's an idea. You see the pattern. Urshanabi says, okay, here's an idea. Cut down some trees, make long poles of them, and you can kind of punt your way across the waters of death. But if you ever touch that water, you're dead. So they go across the water, the ferryman and Gilgamesh, and he comes to a shore, and he sees an old man, and he talks to the old man, and the old man warns him, and he says, death is inevitable. It's futile to try to avoid death. Only gradually Gilgamesh realizes that he's talking to Utnapishtim. He thought that Utnapishtim would be this superhuman. Instead, it's a little old man, a very kindly old man, too. Now we're in Tablet 11, the famous book. And he tells the story of the flood, which I've already told pretty much, I think. And at the end, Utnapishtim offers Gilgamesh immortality. Once again, the gods relenting, saying no, 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 but then changing their minds, relenting, changing their minds. Mercifully, it seems, but looked at seriously from the point of view of the author, when the gods change their minds and relent, they know that man is incapable of doing these things that they're offering to man, of fulfilling the tasks, performing the feats that we must perform in order to find immortality. They know that we're not going to be successful. Of course they know that. Okay, if you, Gilgamesh, can stay awake for 6 days and 7 nights, I will make you immortal. Gilgamesh says, thank you. And he sits down and falls asleep right away. He doesn't even last 12 hours. He falls asleep right away. Now, Utnapishtim says to his wife, now, men are liars. This is profound stuff, I think. Men are liars. When Gilgamesh wakes up, he will deny that he fell asleep. He will deny it all, because that's what we do. So, I want, for each day that he sleeps, wife, please bake a loaf of bread, and we'll set it at Gilgamesh's feet. For each day, 7 days pass. 7 days, a loaf for each day. Gilgamesh wakes up, and sure enough, he denies that he slept. He just slept for a minute, for a second. Utnapishtim shows him the loaves of bread, the oldest in a state of decay, each of the other ones more recent. It's obvious that they've been there They tell no lie. There it is. And Gilgamesh, oh, I'm a worthless something, as we tend to do, but we can't. We are incapable of believing. So we're caught lying. We can't deny that we lie. And we do this other thing that we do well. Oh, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Oh, which is also our humanity. Okay. Wife, Utnapishtim's wife then says, oh, well, let's give him a break. Okay. They tell him about some secret magic plant at the bottom of the ocean. If he can get that magic plant, and if he can eat it, he will be immortal. Now watch this. This is good. Gilgamesh attaches heavy stones to his feet. Down to the bottom of the ocean he goes, finds the plant, brings it back up. But he then is the ferryman ferries him back across because he will go home. But he doesn't trust Utnapishtim. He doesn't trust the gods, basically, who tell him about this plant. So he's going to test it, first of all, on an old man back at Uruk. Oh, come on. So even if we're given the chance for immortality, the various qualities that we have are our human frailty, that is, need of sleep and food, which will come out again here. Our inability to entirely trust God. Take the man who is most full of faith and put him in a room and then send a snake or send a lion into the room. Will he be afraid? Of course he will. Of course he will. Is this faith? No, we're incapable of it. We're incapable of it. We're play actors. And we will invent lies why we were afraid too. It's the way we are, and the most important thing about the way we are is, even when we're capable of finding the way we are, we will find ways to deny it. Embellish and deny it. Change it to something more favorable to ourselves. Our infinite vanity and fear lie at the bottom of us. Okay, so he couldn't even trust the gods enough to eat the plant. Okay, he's ferrying across, they stop at the tavern, and then exhausted, the ferryman too, and Gilgamesh, eat at the tavern, and then sleep. Sleep. The one thing if he had to keep the plant, at least he could not sleep. Of course, what he should have done is eaten the plant right away, trusted the gods, but he couldn't do that. While he's sleeping, a snake slithers in, eats the plant. As a result, the snake is able to slough off its skin every year and become a kind of symbol of immortality. What does this mean to us? It means, yes, Gilgamesh should have trusted Utnapishtim, and Mrs. Utnapishtim should have eaten the plant, but no. So now he's done it again. He had another chance at it, and he blew the chance. He squandered the chance. So Ur-Shanabi takes him back across the waters of death, he's already done that, takes him back to Uruk, and the story ends, the very end of the poem, with Gilgamesh showing Ur-Shanabi, the ferryman, the great city of Uruk. Look at this great city, look at its walls, look at its masonry, its stonework, look at these great gates, cedar. Enkidu and I killed Humbaba and cut down the cedar, the wonderful cedar forest, and made our great gates of this. Isn't this impressive, Ur-Shanabi? He tries to impress Ur-Shanabi. Now, I haven't read this part literally before. Take 1 second. He looked at the walls. Yeah. Return to Uruk. All this very short. He became a better man. Good. Gilgamesh became a better man, a better king, no more causing his people sorrow, and he lived a long life and was a great and good king. That's good. The pathetic attempt to impress Ur-Shanabi, though, is still on my mind. I wonder if at the end of his life, let's say he lived to be 120, as I think, according to the Chronicles, he lived a pretty long life. I wonder if at 120 he still would have tried to impress Ur-Shanabi with the walls and the city and all that. I suspect he would have. But at least he became a decent man. Now, let's look at it, try to get an overview here. The poem ends on that note. Let's take Gilgamesh at the beginning, his sexual voracity, his cruelty, really, his pathological lust, which really is the desire to enjoy power by forcing suffering, forcing others to suffer. By the end, after all he's been through, the loss of Enkidu, the friendship with Enkidu, the adventures, the loss of Enkidu, more adventures, he has become a much more moderate man, a temperate man, and apparently a good king. So he's changed. He's a wiser man. At least he's more prudent. Wisdom, the closest a human being can get to wisdom, I'm afraid, is prudence, caution. No, I will not drink excessively because... And I fear that at the bottom of prudence, okay, let me try to explain what I mean here. What is human wisdom? Human wisdom is mostly prudence. Prudence, being cautious. I'm not going to drink too much. I'm going to sleep soundly. I'm going to try to eat a healthy diet. I'm going to be moderate in my views, in my emotions too. I don't think this is wisdom. This is only prudence. And what is at the bottom of prudence? A desire to live a long life. In other words, a fear of death. So at the basis of wisdom, I'm afraid, most human wisdom, we have only prudence, and prudence is only a desire to lead a long life. If that's all wisdom is, then it's a very pathetic thing. And it's as pathetic almost as anything else we do. It's just fear of death, a desire for longevity. Is that the best we can do? Maybe. Maybe. Is that very good? I don't think so. Not very impressive. And none of us can be very impressed by it. Though it's a lot better than Gilgamesh at the beginning. At least he's not inflicting pain on others. He's trying to do the right thing. Maybe that's the best. But at the basis of that, I think, is prudence. A kind of prudence. I wonder what the author would say, or the authors. But it's infinitely, like all great works, debate can go on and on and on. Meaningful debate. It's wonderful. It is a great poem, although it comes down to us in a mangled, truncated, abbreviated, or abridged form. Gilgamesh's struggle with his own mortality is a great, great thing. Did it influence Greek myth and Homer? Obviously. Kirk says, obviously. If he says it, there it is. We're here getting at the root or the source of the greatest, one of the greatest stories we have ever told, anyway. So, I think that's enough. Thank you.